The period of music that preceded that of the 20th century was one dominated by romantic music. Popular forms of the time were program music, or an instrumental work that is associated with a piece of art or a text of some sort, concerto form, which was basically a piece that increased the role of the orchestra from that of an accompaniment to a role of main focus or importance. Sonata form was similar to a concerto in the sense that the role of piano accompaniment was brought to the forefront and gave the piano accompaniment a role of focus or importance. Sonatas were commonly broken up into three or four sections called movements. Each movement is broken down into parts. The first is called the exposition, where you hear the main tune or key. Next comes the development, and during this section it leaves the main key, and it sounds unstable and creates tension, so the listener wants to return to the main key. The last part is the recapitulation, where the piece is ended in the main key, and it resolves any tension from the development, thus leaving the listeners happy.
With the coming of Impressionist art movement and with the world wars and world events of the time, there was a visible change in music as many musicians started experimenting with new forms that strayed from the traditional harmonies and forms from the late Romantic period. As a result, the 20th century had no single dominant style, unlike the century before. In general, there is no single sound that defines this era, as it was a mishmash of a variety of different kinds of styles.
Schoenberg was part of the chromaticism and atonality movement. Chromatic music is not as soft as impressionist music, which shocked the music world.
The chromatic movement began during the preceding Romantic era. The notes of the chromatic scale, which consists of pitches that are each a semitone above or below the previous one, were slowly introduced into romantic compositions during that time and eventually became very popular.
Eventually, the romantic aspects of the composition that accompanied the chromatic traits disappeared, leaving the chromatic aspects by themselves. But also by leaving the romantic parts behind, it took away the tonal center of the composition, thus creating atonality. The tonal center is a fixed reference point of the piece, which helps the listener have a specific sound to guide them through the rest of the piece.
This idea of atonality is shown throughout his pieces and is one of his major contributions to music and the success of the chromaticism movement. One of his most famous works is titled Transfigured Night. This song has many aspects that make it influential and interesting.
This piece is a sextet, a piece that calls for six-string instruments. In this case, it was two violins, two violas, and two cellos. The reason this piece is notable is because instead of being arranged in the traditional sonata format, a format that is mostly made up of the piano that was popular at the time, this piece is divided into five sections according to the stanzas of the poem that inspired it, Transfigured Night by Richard Dummel. Schoenberg focused on how each individual piece of the composition fit together rather than how the music sounds as a whole. This unique piece combines sonata form with four movement format, which confused music lovers.
This ever-transforming piece is separated into sections through the use of dynamics, or the volume of the notes, and meter changes, or changes in the beats per measure. For example, Schoenberg uses ritardandos to slow down a piece, while he used fermatas to prolong a note's duration. He also used other techniques, such as modulation, where he changed the key up and down to evoke emotion, paralleling that of the poem in dominant preparation.
Explores the intersection between chromatic and diatonic harmony, which are opposites. To break that down, the prefix dia is Greek for across or through, and tonic means center. So basically, a diatonic harmony is a piece that only uses chords and notes that are a part of a certain key. For example, a diatonic harmony played in C major would only use the notes that are contained with that major. In this case being C, D, E, F, G, A, and B. In the case of a chromatic harmony, the chords and the notes played would not have to be limited to only those in the key. This composition technique, though it may only be a subtle change, is great enough to create a shift in the tone of a piece.
All in all, Schoenberg made a great impact on modern music. However, the thing he is most well known for, and is something that is still very influential in musical composition, would be his 12-tone technique. Thank you.
This technique is also called dodecaphony and was made by Schoenberg to make sure that all 12 notes of the chromatic scale are used equally throughout the piece.
The music isn't put into a key like C major that was demonstrated, thus avoiding the emphasis of any one note.
Another artist that really made an impact on modern electronic music, like dubstep, is Karlheinz Stockhausen.
Stockhausen was part of the serialism movement. In a serial composition, there is a pattern that repeats throughout the whole composition. Serial music wasn't widely accepted because not many people really understood it. Many critics believe that it was very difficult for people without a musical background to understand. The serial technique is very specific, and many composers are very precise when composing. Two of Stockhausen's works, Play for Orchestra and Percussion Quartet, were never published because he felt he didn't do a good enough job with this. The serial technique with normal instruments, which then led him into electronic music.
The demands of serial music is what led to the exactness that Stockhausen put into his music. The philosophy that makes him influential in music is not the fact that he was a serial composer, but that he took control of every aspect of his music. He changed things so that they would fit together perfectly. He recorded his music so that it moved around the listener, an aspect of music that wasn't normally considered. Stockhausen considered his music a malleable material, like clay, that he could change and make into anything he wanted. This ability to change his music as he liked is what led him to synthetic music.
Study 1 was composed in 1953 and was one of the first pieces that Stockhausen used sine waves in his composition. Another piece was a sprawling opera cycle called Liegt, which is one of the first times we see him using mythology and religious texts as his inspiration for his compositions. Simmung was his first famous one using singers and lyrics woven into the composition. All of these compositions lead to one of his major works, Gesang der Jünglinge. This piece was composed in 1954. It was inspired by the time that Stockhausen was composing and focusing on his religion. The youths referred to in the title are from the Bible's Book of Daniel. These children were thrown into a fiery furnace because they wouldn't worship an idol. The lyrics in this piece are 11 of the verses that were sung by the children. However, all that can be heard repeating is "Praise the Lord." The rest can't be heard over the electronic fire. Stockhausen called it a non-liturgical religious work, meaning that it is a religious piece but is not used in worshiping. and planned for it to be performed in the Cologne Cathedral in Germany. This did not happen because the church authorities thought the loudspeakers to be inappropriate.
This piece is also one of the first pieces to move throughout space. This piece was composed for 5 loudspeakers surrounding the audience. Stockhausen composed the music to make it move from speaker to speaker, making it seem as if the music was moving clockwise and counterclockwise all around the audience.
This piece also uses 6 different types of scales: harmonic, subharmonic, chromatic, and 3 others that blended these 3 together. The goal of this piece for Stockhausen was to fuse the human voice with the electronic music, making it seem as though it's all one piece of music. In order to do this, he transposed and changed the boy's voice so that he could incorporate it with the composition seamlessly. He transposed the boy's voice into a timbre that ranged from pure tone that resembled sung vowels to aperiodic sounds that sound like plosive consonants. The letters B, P, T, D, K, and G. In order to make these sounds, Stockhausen used sine waves. Aperiodic sounds are sounds that are one cycle of a sine wave, and therefore do not repeat, while pure tones can be multiple cycles of the sine wave. He picked the sung Bible verses apart and placed the pieces individually into the recordings so that they fit in with the composition. Karlheinz Stockhausen made a great impact on music by taking complete control of his composing and helping to propel the serial technique, eventually leading to the music that we have today. Reich's influences are derived from post-war jazz, African drumming, Béla Bartók, a Hungarian composer, and Igor Stravinsky, a Russian composer. Reich's pieces can be characterized by fixed rhythmic pulses, steady state, tonality, and an unremitting focus on a single unfolding pattern, which are defined as non-stop repetitions of the same sound. One of Reich's primary methods of composing was phasing. Thank you.
Phasing was the earliest technique developed by Reich and is known for its multiple looping discovered via tape. The second technique Reich made use of was musical language, which is marked by the substitution of beats for rests, or pauses, until the pattern is revealed. Reich's vision consisted of canon melody, which is a melody that is simply repeated after a certain amount of time, and speech melody, which is when a piece of music is generated by taking a fragment of recorded speech and approximating it with musical notes. Both of these melodies are repetitive, unified, strict, and abstract. Many of Reich's works required amplification and a sound engineer.
What Reich is most notable for is the creation of minimalism. Minimalism is a music style defined by pared-down design elements and commonly utilizes repetition, which Reich incorporates with his technique of phasing. These are simple techniques, which is why they are considered minimalistic.
One of Reich's well-known pieces is called Come Out. This piece was produced in 1966 and features tape loops that are derived from changing the times at which each piece was recorded.
I had to, like, open the blues up and let some of the blues blood come out to show them.
Come Out is based on the retrial of the Harlem Six, six African-American youths that were arrested for a murder committed during the Harlem riot of 1964. A civil rights activist by the name of Truman Nelson requested Reich to compose this piece using the tapes of the recorded voices taken straight from the retrial. Reich complied to Nelson's request, leading to the production of this piece. The voice Reich decided to use is of Daniel Hamm, one of the Harlem Six.
At the beginning of Come Out, Daniel Hamm is heard saying, "I had to, like, open the bruise up and let some of the bruised blood come out to show them." Reich then re-recorded the fragment, "Come Out to Show Them," on two channels and at first played them in sync. At the 38-second mark, Reich plays one of the recorded fragments a fraction of a second off of the original, utilizing his phasing technique.
Gradually, the time between the two recordings widens and an echo is created. The two voices then split into four voices, which are looped continuously until they split again, becoming eight. The voices eventually become unrecognizable, turning into separate syllables that are formed into a pattern.
Reich himself states, "By not altering its pitch or timbre, one keeps the original emotion and power that speech has, while intensifying its melody and meaning through repetition and rhythm. Therefore, the sounds used in Reich's pieces are unedited. The only changes that Reich makes is clipping shorter segments of the original to produce his phasing effect. With the use of phasing and repetition of a single pattern, Come Out is a prime example of process music, or music that the composer purposely makes the process of composing audible to the listener."
Another piece by Reich is called Drumming. This piece was influenced by the African culture. This piece uses phasing and is based on a single rhythmic pattern, like many of Reich's pieces before this. Drumming is 90 minutes long, split into three sections, and called for more musicians Reich has ever required. It also introduced a new technique of substitution notes with rests or pauses. This creates sudden shifts in the flow of the piece, since particular notes are exchanged with rest to form a series of variations of the original pattern.
In this next piece, called The Desert Music, Reich exploited the full timbral range of the ensemble while maintaining the tempo and intricate counterpoint of his works for smaller forces. Timbral, which is just another way of classifying timbre, is the quality of a musical note, sound, or tone that distinguishes different types of sounds, like voices and instruments.
Reich himself said, "It is the principle of music to repeat the theme. Repeat and repeat again as the pace mounts. The theme is difficult, but no more difficult than the facts to be resolved. Those at all familiar with my music know how apt these words are for me, and particularly this piece which, among other things, addresses that basic ambiguity between what the text says and its pure sensuous sounds."
In Reich's piece called The Cave, there are three acts which suggest a new type of musical theater involving audio-visual technology to record, interpret, and present its subjects in an entirely modern context.
Although Reich isn't the first person that comes to people's minds when asked who made an impact to modern-day music, one can't deny that he did through his minimalistic music style and phasing technique.
We can see the influence of Schoenberg's various techniques, most notably the 12-tone scale, all the way out to another one of the pioneers of modern music, John Cage.
Much of Cage's earlier works have been lost. However, much of it consisted on things that focus on rhythmic structure, namely by bringing it to the forefront of the piece. As a student under Schoenberg, Cage studied diligently under the man he not only regarded as his teacher, but as someone he aspired to be. However, after some time under his tutelage, Cage decided to leave. This was due mostly to the fact that Cage had differing ideas about form. Cage liked to compose pieces with oddly divided sections that not only differed from traditional sonata form and as a result creating a unique rhythm.
A piece of his that demonstrates this very nicely is Imaginary Landscape No. 1. In this piece, he divides it up into four large sections of 16, 17, 18, and 19 bars, also known as measures, a period that contains a specific amount of beats based off of the meter given. Each section is divided into four subsections, the first three of which were all 5 bars long. Overall, this creates a major focus on the rhythm of the piece as opposed to the harmony or the main chords in the piece.
From here, Cage moved into his works using the prepared piano. A prepared piano is a piano that has its sounds altered by putting objects, known as preparations, such as silverware, between the strings, hammers, or dampers. Cage personally used nails and bits of rubber that he put under a normal piano in order to create a full percussion in piano section. He applied both his unique rhythm techniques combined with the prepared piano to create new and creative pieces that not only flowed differently, but also created quirky and unexpected sounds as well. His most famous and complex piece for the prepared piano is Sonatas and Interludes, which is a cycle of 20 short works consisting of 16 sonatas and 4 interludes, or a short piece of music. It takes around 2 to 3 hours to assemble the piano for this piece alone, and the proportions used to break up the staffs and measures are fractions as well as whole numbers.
After this period of experimentation with prepared music, Cage had always been somewhat interested in the Eastern and Asian texts, philosophies, and traditions, as seen with sonatas and interludes, which was inspired by the Indian philosophy. Cage wanted to create music that removed the composer from the process of creating the music, so that he was creating something that was less of a result of a composer's ego, and something that placed more emphasis on the actual work itself as opposed to the performers, audience, or creator. This belief probably also evolved with the influences of his open-minded and innovative thinking friends, such as Marcel Duchamp, as well as the influence of the principles of Zen, which he hoped to incorporate into his art. He regarded the intentions of the composer too unimportant, something that threatened the heritage of music tradition.
Cage tried to get rid of the intervention of a composer by putting his music into charts. For example, he used a star map and added staff lines to them, thus making it into the compositional piece, Etudes Australes. However, the most notable resource that he used for chance operations was the I Ching. By using this text, he was able to ask intricate questions that pertain to each aspect of the piece, and then use the I Ching to answer them or translate them. To further explain how Cage used it to create chance operations, it's first important to understand what the I Ching is and what it's used for. The I Ching, also known as the Book of Changes, is one of the oldest classic texts. The book was originally used as a cosmological and philosophical guide. It centered on the ideas of the dynamic balance of opposites, the evolution of events as a process, and acceptance of the inevitability of change.
To use the I Ching, one must first make a hexagram. One hexagram is made up of two trigrams, which consists of three lines. Thus, one hexagram is made up of six lines. There are two kinds of lines that make up all trigrams. The first is called a dark line. The second is called a light line. There are also line transformations. A dark line with a dot then becomes a transformed dark line, which means that it should be turned into a light line, while a light line with a dot then changes into a dark line.
Starting with your question in mind, you grab three coins that has two different sides. The head side is worth three and the tail side is worth two. You will then take the three coins and toss them. Then you will tally up the number worth of the coins that you tossed. Using the following guidelines, you then draw the line that corresponds to your sum. You then repeat this five more times for a grand total of six times. You then look at the two trigrams you have just constructed and reference the chart in the back of the I Ching. This will then give you a character, which you will then look up in the I Ching.
The results of using the I Ching as a way to create these chance operations resulted in an unusual assortment of sounds and continuity in his pieces. One great piece that demonstrates the unpredictable shifts caused by these operations would be Music of Changes. It's a piece that truly embodies Cage's shifting view of music. Cage wanted to produce useful music, or rather, music that transcends its status as an artwork and focuses towards everyday conduct of humanity and life. Likewise, other pieces like Concert for Piano and Orchestra allowed musicians to perform individual pages in the order that they wished, and Music for Piano, which allowed each performance of the piece to be unique and different.
Another thing that Cage commonly did while composing was using pre-planned times, and from there he would try to fit the composition into this time slot. This is actually how the name of Cage's most controversial and well-known piece he ever composed came into being, 4:33.
And now, a performance of John Cage's 4:33. Please welcome our soloist, William Marx.
As stated, this piece is 4 minutes and 33 seconds long. However, this is not what it is most well known for. When first unveiled at a 1952 recital of contemporary music, this piece both offended and stunned the crowd as they waited for John Cage to begin playing. However, Cage just walked over to the piano and closed the lid. He then opened it later to mark the end of the first movement, and subsequently repeated this process for the second and third movements as well. This became so important and controversial because it challenged what was traditionally classified as music. To Cage, any sound may be counted as music, and for this reason, Cage has stated in many interviews that he considers this to be his most important work.
In the song itself, the only thing that can be heard are the background noises that come from the audience. As a result, These incidental and unintentional noises represent tension that is created between the undesirable sounds, or in this case, the sounds from the audience, and the desirable noises, or the musical notes intended by the composer. By using only the sounds and letting them just be sounds, they are not influenced by any other forces, and this, coupled with the fact it's different each time it's performed, allowed each viewer to have their own unique experience of the piece.
This piece wasn't just Cage's way of challenging what defines music, but it also served as a challenge to the traditional concert etiquette. By choosing a very prestigious concert and venue to debut this piece, the audience already had great expectations going in. As a result, they listened to the piece with the same intensity they would some other great masterpiece. Finally, 433's title, as mentioned before, was named for its duration. However, its significance extends beyond this. To Cage, duration of a piece is an essential building block for music. It's also something that silence and music share. Time is still time, whether it be filled with sounds or not, and this is one of the main points Cage was trying to demonstrate through 433.
Despite many controversial pieces, Cage's bold experimentation in chance music, prepared music, among other things, has left him as one of the most influential and well-known composers to date.
Many of the changes that these artists made are seen in modern music still. In the song Murder Mystery by the Velvet Underground, they used the techniques that were used by Karlheinz Stockhausen to have the song move throughout the room, switching speakers as each different member is talking.
While these musicians aren't well known today, they were revolutionary for their time. They made changes to music that changed the course of music for the future. Most of the pieces discussed may seem weird or confusing, but are really some of the building blocks for modern music.
Without these artists doing what they did, we would not have the same modern music that we all love. Dimension as a science fact, she is disarmed by rats. There's one way to skin a cat of poison, a rat, and a sit for a hit.